Were dinosaurs warm-blooded or cold-blooded or something else entirely? Welcome to the Natural History of Dinosaurs. My name is Benjamin Berger. I'm a paleontologist at Utah State University teaching in the heart of Utah's dinosaur country in Vernal. In this video, I'll define the terms endotherm, ectotherm, poikilotherm, and homeotherm, and how they relate to that misnomer of cold-blooded versus warm-blooded animals. Endotherm is applied to organisms that regulate their temperatures internally. You, right there, you're an excellent endotherm since you regulate your body temperature to around 98.6 degrees Fahrenheit or 37 degrees Celsius. Ectotherm is applied to organisms that regulate their body temperatures using external sources of heat. Body temperatures can range due to the amount of sunlight that's coming in or the time of day. Now, turtles can warm their bodies from about 8 degrees Celsius to 37.8 degrees Celsius. The primitive lizard sphenodon can range from 6.2 to 18 degrees Celsius. The alligator can regulate its temperature between about 26 to 37 degrees Celsius, snakes from about 9 to 38 degrees Celsius, and lizards can regulate their temperatures between 11 and 46.4 degrees Celsius. That's hot blood. In fact, many lizards have much warmer blood than we humans do, almost 10 degrees Celsius higher. And that's because they can survive in really hot deserts. The term poikilotherm means that the organisms have a broad, wide range of body temperatures that they can live at, while the term homeotherm means that there is a tiny range of temperatures that the organism can live within. Now, we humans, we have to maintain a very narrow body temperature. So we're both homeotherms and endotherms. Lizards, on the other hand, can have a wide range of body temperatures. So they're both poikilotherms and ectotherms, since they need to use the external environment to regulate their temperatures. However, lizard blood could be both hotter or colder than human blood. So it's a bit of a misleading to call lizards cold-blooded. Now, there are distinct advantages to being homeothermic and endothermic, and that's because you have the energy ready at any time to escape a predator. You don't have to increase your energy to heat up your body, as your body's already at a stable temperature and ready to go at any time. However, there's a downside to having homeothermic and endothermic bodies. You need to eat a lot of food to keep the same temperature. You need to fuel the furnace inside your body. Animals that are poikilotherm and ectotherm, they don't have to eat as often as animals that regulate their body temperatures like we do. All right, so what were dinosaurs? Were they homeothermic or were they poikilotherm? Were they endothermic or ectothermic? Well, we have two lines of evidence that they were both maintained at least a body temperature that was in a more narrow range, so being more homeothermic than poikilotherm. And that is that many of them appear to have been feathered, or at least they had some insulation, especially many of the theropods that we've looked at. Second, most of the dinosaurs appear to have utilized an air sac system for their respiration, for breathing. This is very similar to what you see in birds, and birds have a very narrow body temperature that they maintain, and they also regulate it, so they are homeotherm and endotherms. Now you should be able to define the terms endotherm, ectotherm, and poikilotherm, and homeotherm.